Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Welcome to today's segment of Juz by Juz Quranic Summaries. We're on Juz 27 inshaAllah, and we're going to be looking at the various surahs and the chapters that are found in the surah, and discussing the summary of these chapters of the Quran. So Juz 27, it begins by a discussion of a few prophets very briefly, and some lessons that you and I can derive from these prophets and their life stories. Again, to reform ourselves and to draw nearer to the Almighty. And if we're on a path of denial and rejection, we get a realization and we turn to the correct path. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins in this chapter 27 by speaking about Lut, alayhi salatu wasalam, the prophet Lut, and how the angels that came to Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, they also now came and visited the prophet Lut alayhi salatu wasalam, and they came with the warning of the punishment because his community was engaged in sodomy and things that were Islamically morally incorrect according to the religion. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights some aspects of the story of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam ila fir'auna bi sultanin mubin. That Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he was sent with signs, and he was an authorized prophet. Meaning that these prophets, they don't claim prophethood without the authority from the Almighty. They are given that trust of prophethood, and therefore they convey it. So Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, is no different. He is not forging and bringing about this claim of prophethood without being a genuine prophet. He is a genuine, authentic prophet authorized by the Almighty, just like many other prophets prior to him were authorized, including Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Then Allah describes the nation of Ad. مَا تَذَرُ مِن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا جَعَلَتْهُ كَالرَّمِيمِ. But look at what happened to the nation of Ad. They had strength, they had authority, they had position in this world. However, none of this helped them. Allah says, the way I destroyed them is مَا تَذَرُ مِن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا جَعَلَتْهُ كَالرَّمِيمِ. They became like dust particles. Meaning that the destruction was so severe that there's no sign of them left. So this is the power and the might of the Almighty. Again, a warning to the Quraysh who were receiving these verses, the first recipients of these verses. And the warning again is that turn away from your rejection and come onto the path of truth, of honesty, of dignity, and Allah and the path of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. Furthermore, Allah describes the nation of Thamud. فَأَخَذَتْهُمُ الصَّاعِقَةُ وَهُمْ يَنظُرُونَ. That when the punishment came to Thamud because of their rejection and their denial, it came all of a sudden. There were warnings, but there was no specific notice that said, you know, the punishment is going to come on this specific day, at this specific hour, at this specific time. It came as a surprise to them, and that surprise led to their failure and their destruction. So what they were mocking about, what they played around with, was in reality the truth that the Prophet Salih alayhi salatu wasalam was warning his community about. And Allah says that it came at such a surprise, وَهُمْ يَنْظُرُونَ, that they were bewildered and seeing that all this destruction is happening, and they are also going to be usurped into this destruction. Then Allah highlights Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا قَوْمَ سَوْءٍ فَاسِقِينَ. That the nation of Nuh, what resulted to their drowning? Allah says they were a community that went beyond limits. Everything requires a boundary, a limit, a protocol, rules. In everyday life, we adhere to protocols and rules, even for simple things that are day-to-day mundane activities. There are rules and there are boundaries and there are limits. And if we cross those limits, that's where the chaos begins. So Allah says here that the nation of Nuh, they cross limits. Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam for 950 years invited them, but they continued to reject and deny. So Allah says, because of their transgressing of limits, that resulted in their punishment. So again, the reminder is from all of these past communities is learn from them. Study their outcome, study what happened to them, and reform ourselves through the lessons that we learn from these life stories of the past communities. As this surah comes to a conclusion in Juz 27, Allah says, فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ, that flee to God. Flee away from your idols and your false notions and your attachments to this worldly and material life. Flee away from it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning focus on the Almighty and follow His path, and that will lead to bliss of this world, enjoyment and peace of this world, as well as the everlasting life of the hereafter. And then the reminder of the famous verses also in this chapter, in Juz 27, and that is the objective of our life. Allah says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, I have created humankind as well as the jinn kind for my slavery, for my worship. So that is the purpose of life. And while we engage in looking for our sustenance in this world and enjoying the blessings of the Creator in this world, we can never forget the Almighty and our objective, that we are His slaves and we are in service to Him through worship and through acknowledging His greatness. Moving on to the next surah in this juz, this is Surah Tur. Tur refers to the Mount of Tur, also known as Mount Sinai. And because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes a mention of this mountain, and it is the Tur mountain where the Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam received revelation and was selected as a prophet. So because of this mention in the surah, this is why the title of the surah is Surah Tur. It's a Mekki surah, which means that there will be discussion surrounding our creed of the oneness of God, of Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, being an authorized prophet, as well as the fact that there is a life to come after we are resurrected, and that is an everlasting life. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam often recited Surah Tur in his prayer. We also find that Jubair ibn Mut'im radiyallahu anhu, there's a report that Jubair ibn Mut'im radiyallahu anhu came to negotiate from Mecca. And he came to Medina, and he was inspired by this surah. The Prophet, when he asked the people of Medina, where is Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him? So they said, he's in the masjid. And this is where a believer should be found, in good places. If someone is looking for us, they should find us in masjids. They should find us volunteering for positive causes. They should find us in our homes. They should find us in places where there's pleasant things going on. They should not locate us or find us in evil places, or places where sin takes place, or where corruption is going on, or where deception is taking place. Rather, in places of peace and prosperity. So in this surah, Allah speaks about various things about the punishment. Now Jubair ibn Mut'im, when he arrived in Medina, someone directed him that you're looking for Muhammad, he's in the masjid. The Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, was leading prayer, and he was reciting surah, وَالطُّورِ وَكِتَابٍ مَسْطُورٍ فِي رَقٍ مَنْشُورٍ. He was reciting these verses, and it hit his heart. And he mentions himself, the verses penetrated my heart, and at that moment I made a conviction, I made a resolution that I'm going to embrace Islam. And while doing the negotiations with the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, on behalf of the Meccans, he embraced Islam. So even though this was a Mekki surah, it was revealed in Mecca, but the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, often recited it in his prayers, even in his life in Medina. And as we just discussed, the Sahaba were inspired by these verses, and Jubair ibn Mut'im radiallahu anhu embraced Islam through the verses of Surah At-Tur. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes an oath at the beginning of the surah of various creations of His, the Mount of Tur, the Torah, the Holy Book, the Torah, the Baytul Ma'mur, which is the Kaaba for the angels. Allah takes the oath of the sky and the sea. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after taking all of these oaths, He mentions that the punishment and the day of judgment, the next life, is a reality. Allah doesn't need to take an oath at all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever He says is absolute. But when he takes an oath, it gives us realization through these creations that Allah has taken an oath of. So we know Mount Tur exists. So just like it exists, that this next life will exist. It is to come. Just like the sky is above us, we see it every day, it exists, no one can deny it. Similarly, the next life is to come, it will exist. The hellfire, the paradise, it exists. It's a reality, it's truth. We need to understand and we need to believe and prepare for the positive of the hereafter. So that's what is the general theme of the surah. Allah is speaking about the disbelievers and their rejection. And Allah, opposing to that, speaks about the righteous believers, how they are dedicated and committed. Allah also highlights that the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, is the final messenger. In the line of prophethood, many prophets came. They received the revelations. But in this line of prophethood, the final prophet is Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. An interesting point in this surah, in this chapter, Surah Tur, is that Allah asks 10 rhetorical questions. Allah makes a statement through rhetorical questions in 10 verses. And they all begin with wording or the terminology am in Arabic, which means do you or. So Allah says, for example, am ta'muruhum. Are you commanding or are you instructing, or is it Allah who is in authority? أَمْ لَهُ الْبَنَاتُ وَلَكُمُ الْبَنُونَ. Is it that you choose for yourself male offspring, but then when you talk about God, you say that He has, نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ, He has daughters? And then أَمْ يُرِيدُونَ كَيْدًا. Are they planning? Whereas Allah is the best planner. So Allah is rhetorically making statements, and as we know, that what it refers to is not really, Allah is not looking for a response, Allah is proving a point. Allah is making a declaration through this may. So very interestingly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about the realization of various discussions surrounding belief and disbelief through these 10 rhetorical questions. So we get into the surah. As the surah opens, Allah says, "Inna adhaba rabbika lawaqi'," that the punishment is going to occur. Waqi' means that it's going to come into existence. You cannot deny it. Even if you deny it, your eyes and your presence will witness the day of judgment and the reality of it. And then Allah highlights paradise and hellfire, and Allah says, for example, in one of the verses here, إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي جَنَّاتِ النَّعِيمِ وَوَقَاهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ عَذَابَ الْجَحِيمِ. Allah says that those who are righteous, those who are God-fearing, those who are mindful of the Almighty, they will be in gardens of bliss, Jannah. And وَوَقَاهُمْ عَذَابَ الْجَحِيمِ. Allah would have protected them from the torment of the hellfire. أَمْ يَقُولُونَ تَقَوَّلَهُ. Do they say that this Qur'an is fabricated? It's not fabricated. It is a reality. It is truth. وَاصْبِرْ لِحُكْمِ رَبِّكَ فَإِنَّكَ بِأَعْيُنِنَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes this surah with the instruction of patience to the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. That despite their denial, their rejection, their turning away from you, wasbir, be patient with them. Continue to advise them and give them the reminder. فَإِنَّكَ بِأَعْيُنِنَا. Allah says, I'm observing everything, so therefore I will give the returns for those who believe, and I will give the consequence for those who reject and those who deny. This concludes Surah At-Tur. We move on to the next surah in this juz, Surah Najm. And Najm means the star. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He takes the oath of the star, in fact, the very first word of this surah is one najm, is the star. Allah takes the oath of the star. So therefore, this the name of this surah is a najm, based on the first word of the surah. It's a Makki surah again, so basic concepts relating to creed, fundamental aspects of articles of faith, regarding God, regarding Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, as well as the everlasting life of the hereafter. In the sabab al-nuzul of this verse, meaning that in the background of why this surah was revealed, it was revealed when climax of the disbelievers was about the discussion about fabrication of the Quran. They said Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, has fabricated this book. He has written it himself. He has adopted it from other books. he's not receiving revelation. So this claim of theirs, this so-called objection of theirs, it had escalated to a point where it disturbed the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. It disturbed the believers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to this and proves that Allah has full authority. He is the supreme being. He is the one that selected Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, as the prophet. And therefore, the revelation he's receiving is genuine, it's truth, and it's a reality. It's also the first surah the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, recited in public. We know in the Meccan period of time, the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, in the initial stages, he was asked to conceal his Islam. He would invite people on an individual basis, never in the public sphere in the initial years. Some scholars have said this was a period of 2 years or maximum 2.5 years, where secretly, one-on-one, he would tell people about Islam. So the first time the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, ever made a declaration in public through the verses of the Quran was through the verses of Surah An-Najm. And it's mentioned that the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, upon publicly declaring the surah and reciting, there are many who were inspired and many who took that as an opportunity to abuse and harm the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. It's also the very first surah that was revealed to the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, with a sajda. We know Surah Al-Alaq was the first few verses were the first revelation. But the verses of that surah that has the sajda and the prostration, it wasn't revealed with the first few verses. It was revealed later on. Prior to that, these verses were revealed of Surah An-Najm, where it has the prostration. And the Prophet ﷺ publicly prostrated, and many people with him also prostrated while he prostrated upon reciting the verse of prostration. And some of the enemies of Islam and some of those who were hateful, Utbah, Shaybah, etc., they did not prostrate. Even though everybody else, despite being disbelievers, they prostrated with the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ because they were so moved with the verse of prostration and how the Prophet ﷺ passionately prostrated upon this verse and its recitation. In this surah, Allah highlights the Mi'raj incident as well, that one should never be in doubt in regards to the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, witnessing these various blessings and the various sceneries of the hereafter, the hellfire, the paradise, and also communicating with Allah and receiving revelation. So all of this is highlighted in this surah as well. أَفَتُمَارُونَهُ عَلَىٰ مَا يَرَىٰ Allah says, are they in doubt about what the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, experienced on the night of Mi'raj? Dana fatadalla. He was very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's communicated with the Creator in a physical sense. So this is again a message of this surah, Surah An-Najm. In this surah, Allah speaks about etiquettes of da'wah, how we should communicate with disbelievers who are denying and rejecting. Despite their denial and rejection, it is still our duty to engage in reforming and mentoring and guiding and conveying the message. And that should be done with prime kindness and with compassion, with concern and care. Allah then speaks about hisab and accountability to him. Allah speaks about forgiveness, that even though a person may be drowning in rejection, once they are touched with the truth and they embrace the truth, seek forgiveness, and Allah promises forgiveness as if they have done no denial. And this is the kindness of the Almighty and the forgiveness from the Almighty. And then towards the conclusion of the surah, Allah gives a mention of a few prophets and their communities of the past. And again, so that we can learn from those communities and their activities to reform ourselves, to transform ourselves, and to be on the straight path. So, وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the star as it becomes evident, the light of it, the distance of it. There's so much scientific information related to the terrestrial bodies. And again, from a believer's perspective, We may be amazed at the information of how far that star is, yet by the speed of light, the light of the star reaches us. We're able to see it, and these creations of Allah are huge, but they look so minute and small in the night sky. So there's so much science to it, there's so much amazement to it, but the believer is such that when they hear about all of these amazing facts related to the terrestrial bodies or any creation of God, is we say Subhanallah. We say this is glory of God. This is what Allah has created. It's not there on its own. It's not floating there on its own. There is a power, there is an energy behind that, and that is none other than Allah Himself, the Creator Himself. As we move on in this surah, I highlight a few verses. In huwa illa wahyun yuha. Allah says, don't be in doubt about the revelation. This is true revelation that is being revealed to him. He's not speaking. Muhammad is not speaking. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam is not speaking from his own whims and fancies. He's not bringing about conjecture or thoughts that are fabricated. What he is speaking is accurate. It's revelation from the Creator. Then Allah speaks about the journey of Mi'raj, gives us a description. I highlight one of the verses in the context of these verses. عند سدرة المنتهى عندها جنة المأوى إذ يغشى السدرة ما يغشى ما زاغ البصر وما طغى. Allah speaks about the Prophet ﷺ reaching the pinnacles of Mi'raj and ascension, that even the angel could not join the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, to that point at the elevated station that separates the creations of the heavens and the creations of the earth. And Allah says, مَا زَغَ الْبَصَرُ وَمَا طَغَى. There was nothing confusing or ambiguous for the Prophet. What he saw is what he saw, meaning it was accurate, it was the real thing. It wasn't a vision, it wasn't a dream, it was a reality, whatever he saw on the night of Mi'raj. Then Allah brings the discussion back to about the disbelievers, their rejection, their denial, their worship of idols, etc. And Allah says, "In hiya illa asma'un sammaytumuha." These are but names you have fabricated. So they had names for the idols, Lat, Uzza, Manat. And they would say, this is the god or the idol of respect. This is the god or the idol of prosperity. This is the idol of family. And this is the god that we pray to with regards to anything to do with family. Like this, they gave names and titles, and they connected themes of life to these idols. And they would say that if you have any issue in reference to this particular matter, your business, your family, etc., go to these idols, Manat, Uzza, Thara. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes in some verses some of their names. So Allah says, "In hiya illa asma'un sammaytumuha." These are fabricated, concocted names and concocted titles, but there's no reality behind that. If I say to you that I'm a millionaire, it doesn't mean I become a millionaire. If I said that this pillar that is in the mosque, it's made of gold, it doesn't make it full of gold. What the reality is the reality. And that is, it's not made of gold, and that is, I'm not a millionaire. So just because we've said something, it doesn't make it a reality. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is exactly what the disbelievers did. They carved idols, and then they gave names to these idols, and then they associated certain things with these idols, prosperity, family, business, and they said, this is where you get your problem solved in those fields of life from these idols. So Allah says, these are just names and titles that you've attached to them. There's no reality behind it. All of these things are in the full authority, the control of the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah reminds us that we are accountable to Him. We will stand before the Almighty. He will reward us or He will punish us. لِيَجْزِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسَاءُ السُّوءَ بِمَا عَمِلُوا. Those who did evil, they will get the return of their evil. لِيَجْزِيَ الَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا بِالْحُسْنَى. And those who have done ihsan, they have excelled in their dedication, in their commitment to Allah, and done good in this world, then they will also get a good return in the hereafter. And then towards the conclusion of the surah, Allah speaks about our efforts. سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى. Anyone who does any kind of effort or sacrifice, they will see the result of that in the next life. So that concludes the surah, Surah An-Najm. We move on to the next surah in this Juz 27, Surah Qamar. Qamar refers to the moon. And because this surah speaks about the miracle that was experienced by the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, in reference to the moon. And what was that miracle? The disbeliever said, if you are a true prophet, they said, split the moon in half. And the Prophet ﷺ made dua to Allah. Oh Allah, there's a high chance that they will believe, give me this miracle. And the Prophet ﷺ was blessed with the miracle. He pointed at the moon and it split into half. According to one narration, they were looking at the moon in the direction of mountain of Hira, the mountain of light, where the cave of Hira is. And one piece of the moon was on the right side of the mountain, and the other piece of the moon was on the left side of the mountain. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this miracle of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, that was granted to him, and gives us the lesson that Allah can do whatever He wants, including the fact that He can resurrect us after we have died, after we have become bones and part of the soil. And that is in the authority, the control, and the power of the Almighty. So, because this whole matter is discussed here in Surah Qamar, that's why the title of this surah is Surah Qamar. It's a Makki surah, which means that it was revealed prior to the Prophet ﷺ migrating to Medina. And again, the themes surrounding Makki surahs are about our aqidah. Very simple discussions, but profound, especially for the person who doesn't believe. They are asked to reflect upon everything around us, and thereby worshipping and recognizing that there must be a supreme being, and that supreme being is Allah, is God Himself. The Prophet ﷺ recited these verses at the occasion of Badr, even though these were revealed in Mecca, but at the occasion of Badr, he recited them again to show that truth will prevail. And what Allah says is truth, it's a reality. The Prophet ﷺ is noted to have recited Surah Qamar also in Eid prayers, both Eid al-Fitr prayers as well as Eid al-Adha prayers. He recited verses of Surah Al-Qamar. Now in the surah also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this miracle of the moon splitting and various other miracles that were given to the prophets. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights the arrogance of the disbelievers, that even though the miracle was shown and displayed, for example, to Pharaoh, he denied. So the miracle was shown to the disbelievers, the splitting of the moon, yet they denied. And they said, you've hypnotized us. You've done some black magic on us. In fact, in one of the reports, as I was preparing for the tafsir and this session, I came across a narration where in the narration it's noted that they claim to say that this was a hypnotism. So a magician, he had just come in after the splitting of the moon, and he said, look, I hypnotize. I'm a magician, I hypnotize people, and I can tell you this is not hypnotism that we see. This is truth. So again, what we learn from here is that the arrogance of the disbelievers was so advanced that even witnessing a miracle did not facilitate for them to accept and embrace the truth. And towards the conclusion of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in fact, in the last half of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about various communities of the past, Qawm Thamud, Qawm Ad, Qawm Lut, as usual, in some of the Makki surahs here as well. And Allah poses a question. فَكَيْفَ كَانَ عَذَابِي وَنُذُرْ Allah says, look at how. Will you not see how the end result was, the end outcome was for the disbelieving communities? So the surah begins and talks about the miracle of the moon splitting. وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرِ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرِ The moon split into two. So this is not a fairy tale. It's in the Quran. It did happen. The Prophet ﷺ was given many miracles. Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah says, I counted over a thousand miracles of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. And if we study the hadith and the seerah and the biography, we'll find many of these miracles. Previous nations and communities are highlighted in this surah and their end results, their outcome, as I mentioned in the introduction. So Qawm Nuh, Qawm Thamud, Qawm Ad, Fir'aun and Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And each time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights the lessons for you and I and the reciters of the Quran, and in the context when these were being revealed to the Quraysh, that they should wake up, they should be alert, they should reflect upon what is being said and embrace the truth. Allah then speaks about the Quran. So past communities and the Quran. Past communities, and Allah comes back to the Quran. Past communities, what are the lessons we learn? And then comes back to the Quran. And Allah says, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ. Allah says, the Quran shows you everything that is truth. And it's easy for you to embrace it if you take it. You know, it's not a complicated textbook or algebra or scientific terminology or something that we need to be a rocket scientist for to understand. Majority of the messages of the Quran are straightforward, simple, to the point, so that we could learn and we could embrace it. So Allah says, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ. We have made the Quran very easy to take as a reminder and to take heed. فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرٍ. But is there someone who will internalize the message of the Quran? Is there someone willing to take the message and embrace the Quran? And again, this was revealed in the context of the Quraysh denying and being those who reject the Quran. So Allah is reminding us to take heed and to take lesson from the Quran and from the past nations. وَمَا أَمْرُنَا إِلَّا وَاحِدَةٌ كَلَمْحٍ بِالْبَصَرِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the Day of Judgment. Again, the elements of creed, as we know in Makki surahs, are to believe in one God, which they were denying. They were worshipping multiple gods or idols with God. They were denying the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. And they were denying the reality of another life. They said, this is our life. إِنْ هِيَ إِلَّا حَيَاتُنَا الدُّنْيَا. This is our life. We're limited to the scope of this life. There's nothing such as a new life or resurrection after we die. So Allah says, after explaining the authority, His authority, His power, His might, the miracle of splitting of the moon, the mention of previous nations and how they were destroyed, Allah says, وَمَا أَمْرُنَا إِلَّا وَاحِدَةٌ كَلَمْحٍ بِالْبَصَرِ. It's just a blink of an eye. What we would deem as a blink of an eye, that's Allah's decision. Allah wants us to gain life again after we have died and become the soil and bones. Allah says, I just have to say, kun, be, and it is. There's no planning involved. There's no preparation involved. There's nothing that Allah has to put together in order for resurrection to occur. Kalamhim bil basar. Allah says, just like the wink of an eye, the blink of an eye, it takes a millisecond or less than a second. For Allah, it's even quicker than that. He says, be, and it is. Now we move on in this Juz 27, to the next surah, and that is Surah Ar-Rahman. Ar-Rahman is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it refers to the mercy and the compassion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, before we recite any surah, we usually recite Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of God, most merciful. Rahman, most merciful. Ar-Rahim, most kind. So because this surah starts with Ar-Rahman, that's why the name of this surah is Ar-Rahman. The name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, denoting the mercy and the compassion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This surah is also called Arisul Quran. Aris literally means the bride of the Quran, the adornment of the Quran. So this has been pointed out in reference to this surah. Many other virtues and many other blessings connected to this surah of the Quran. It's a Makki surah by majority Mufassirun, which means that it was revealed prior to the Prophet ﷺ leaving for migration towards Medina. So again, the elements and the discussion, the themes of this surah surround our aqidah, our articles of faith, believing in the one and only God. وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ. There is none worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything goes back to Him. He supremes, He reigns supreme. And then the other is Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. Yes, he is an orphan. Yes, he is a simple person. Yes, he has good character and good morals. And you may not like those positive qualities of his. However, the main thing is he is a prophet. He's chosen. He is receiving revelation from God. And whoever denies that is on the wrong path. And finally, the life of hereafter, that we will live a new life after we die. This life is temporary, and we need to internalize this. If we have the awareness of the next life, if we have the awareness of resurrection and being accountable to God, then we'll be careful in the way we live our life in this world, because we know every movement we make, every choice we make, will be impacted through the decision of what the outcome is because of our choices. If we make positive choices, there's a positive outcome. If we make negative choices, then we will face a negative outcome in the hereafter. And the hereafter, life of the hereafter, is not something someone can escape from. It's not something someone can flee from. It's a reality we'll all have to face. وَإِن مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا وَارِدُهَا Allah says, every individual will have to pass through that. And therefore, we want to internalize the truth of this and prepare for it and accept the truth. What's the sabab al-nuzul for this surah? Why was it revealed? There are many reasons why this surah was revealed, but three are highlighted in the hadith. One is the disbelievers, when they heard the verse of the Quran, usjudu lirrahman, prostrate before the most merciful. They said, who's Rahman? They asked the question, who's Rahman? Who's most merciful? So Allah revealed this entire surah, Ar-Rahman, Allama al-Qur'an. Who is Ar-Rahman? Allah says, I'll tell you who I am. I teach you everything. I bless you with everything. I give you everything. I control everything. There is a next life. There is Jannah. There is Jahannam. There is paradise. There is hellfire. There is resurrection. That is who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Another reason why this surah was revealed is it's mentioned that people objected on calling Allah Rahman. The disbelievers, they said, why should we call Allah Rahman? If Allah is one and He doesn't have any partners, why should we call Him Rahman? Because Rahman is another entity. They would say it's another entity. It's another being. So Allah then says in another portion of the Quran, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى Allah has many beautiful names, 99 according to some scholars. So He has many beautiful names. These names do not denote that there are multiple gods. These names are the names of the same being, the same creator. In fact, they are sifat, they are attributes of the Almighty. So Allah is the name, but Ar-Rahman is an attribute that reminds us about Allah, that denotes the Creator, the most merciful, the all-seeing, the all-hearing, the most powerful, so on and so forth. So that's another reason why this surah was revealed. And by extension, at the occasion of the Hudaybiyah Treaty, which we discussed, I believe, yesterday, is that Suhail, later on he embraced Islam. Suhail radiallahu anhu, he refused to write Ar-Rahman, Bismillahir Rahman, in the name of God, the most merciful. He said, I don't know Rahman, who's Rahman? I'm not going to write Rahman. So the Prophet ﷺ recited the verses of Ar-Rahman to denote that Rahman, the one you may not believe in, we believe in, he is most merciful. And another reason why this surah was revealed is that some of the disbelievers of Mecca, they said Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, is being taught by some stranger. He's being taught by some stranger of the Banu Israel, and he's bringing that to us and telling us it's revelation. So Allah revealed this surah and says, it's Ar-Rahman wa 'allama al-Qur'an. It's Allah, the most merciful, who has taught Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, the Qur'an. It's not some a random person from the Banu Israel or from the Jewish community that is teaching Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. Allah is the teacher. Allah is the source for the Qur'an, and Allah is the being that is sending down the revelation of the Qur'an to Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. Surah Ar-Rahman is noted to be one of the first revelations of the Qur'an. It's also the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, would often recite it in Fajr prayer. When he would be leading the Fajr prayer, he would recite Surah Ar-Rahman. Jinn also heard and also accepted the truth through the message of Surah Ar-Rahman. In fact, in some reports, it's mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ was reciting the Surah Ar-Rahman, either in prayer or outside prayer, and the jinn overheard it. And therefore, they were inspired by it and they embraced Islam. And in fact, at one occasion when the Prophet ﷺ recited the Quran to the Sahaba in a gathering, He recited Surah Ar-Rahman. And every time, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ, which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? Because this is constantly repeated in the Quran. It's actually repeated 31 times. So each time it was repeated, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they were moved. But then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, at the conclusion of reciting the surah, he said, when the jinn heard me recite this Quran, this verse, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ, they responded by saying, لَا شَيْءَ مِن نِعَمِكَ رَبُّنَا نُكَذِّبُ فَلَكَ الْحَمْدِ. There is no blessing that we can deny of yours, O Allah, so you are the worthy of praise. Because فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ means, which of the favors of your Lord shall you deny? So the jinn immediately responded when they heard this verse. They said, there's no favor of yours that we can deny. Every favor of yours, O Allah, we acknowledge, and we say فَلَكَ الْحَمْدِ, for you is all praise, for you is all glory. So the Prophet ﷺ said this to the Sahaba, that say this as well, and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all the blessings He has given us. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu is the companion who recited this surah publicly for the first time. The Prophet ﷺ, he had publicly recited other verses. However, when it came to a companion other than Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was the first to recite publicly the Quran, and he recited Surah Ar-Rahman. And upon that, he was abused, he was harshly dealt with, because this was the beginning of publicly declaring Islam without any hesitation. As I said previously, that the initial stages was that it was one-on-one, secretly, not in public. But then after 2 years or 2.5 years, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that declare to your family, your household. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned to declare openly. And that's when the Prophet ﷺ ascended the Mount of Safa, and he reminded everybody about the truth of Islam. And the details are all there in the books of Seerah. So we said already that فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ is repeated 31 times. And it's not in vain. You see, many authors, what they do is to fill up space, they repeat things. But the Quran, if it ever repeats a word or a sentence, it's not to fill up space. The Quran doesn't need to do this. Allah doesn't fill up space. It's not a filler, as we would say. Allah has repeated every verse, wherever there's a verse being repeated, for an objective and a purpose. So there's a lot of detail written on this topic and this theme, but I'll just share one with you here in this Juz by Juz Quranic Summaries about Surah Ar-Rahman. And that is that every time a new blessing is mentioned, Allah says, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانِ, everyone will, everything and everyone will perish. فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. So that is a blessing that we will come to a perish, but then we'll be resurrected and we'll be made to enter paradise. So that is a blessing. So after that blessing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا, can you deny this blessing? And then another blessing. And then Allah says, can you deny that blessing? So each time a new blessing is mentioned, so it's mentioned 31 times, that means there's 31 blessings being highlighted in the surah. And then Allah says, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. So it's objective, it's purposeful, it's not just simply to fill up the space of the Quran. Also in the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about two types of blessings. One is religious blessings, Quran, knowledge. These are religious and spiritual or intangible blessings. And then Allah speaks about tangible blessings. Allah speaks about the sea. Allah speaks about the creation around us, the waters, the trees, etc., the skies. All of these things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about, they are physical blessings. So material blessings and also spiritual blessings. But what does Allah begin with? Spiritual blessings. He talks about the Quran. He talks about knowledge. So these are more important blessings than the material blessings. And I've said this, and I'm sure you've heard it many times. If a person has iman and they don't have these physical blessings, the material and the wealth or the resources of this world, they are still in success. However, vice versa, that's not the case. A person can have all the wealth and the authority of this world, but if they don't have Iman, they don't have Islam, they're not blessed with the Quran, then they are deprived. So Allah mentions the spiritual blessings first because they are far more important. In this surah, Allah highlights two groups of human beings and four levels of the people of paradise. What's the two groups? The believers and the disbelievers. And then there Allah mentions four levels of paradise. Jannatan. وَلِمَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ جَنَّتَان. There are two levels for the very elite, and then there are another two levels for the believers in general. So obviously the higher the paradise, this means the more serious the believer, the more connected the believer is. So this surah, we've mentioned a number of things that are mentioned, but I'll highlight a couple of verses here. Allah begins with various blessings that He has given us, and this continues throughout the surah. لَا تُخْسِرُ الْمِيزَانِ. Allah reminds us here that never destroy the balance. And this is the key to a successful life. We need to be balanced. When it comes to the material and spiritual, be balanced. Give time to spirituality just like you give time to material. Give time to your family just like you give time to your work. Give time to your internal character and morals just like we give time to our physical bodies and we pay attention to the needs of our physical body. So لا تخسر الميزان. Don't destroy the balance and the justice that is placed between everything that is around us. كل من عليها فان. Allah speaks about our end. And we are all accountable. We are all returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one lives forever. Ya ma'ashal al-jinni wal-insi in istata'tum. Allah speaks about the faculties and the blessings that are given to both humans and jinn. But then Allah says, what can you do against me? Ya ma'ashal al-jinni wal-insi in istata'tum an tanfudhu min aqtari samawati wal-ardi fanfudhu la tanfudhuna illa bisultan. Go as far as you want as a human being or as jinn kind. You will only be able to do what I allow. Meaning authority is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then a scenery of the hellfire, sceneries of the paradises that will be given to various categories of believers. And then to conclude the surah, تَبَارَكَ اسْمُ رَبِّكَ ذِي الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ. At the end of the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reigns supreme. His name is the most elevated, and he is worthy of glory. We continue on in this juz, Surah Waqi'ah. Waqi'ah refers to the occurrence or the event, and it's indicative to the Day of Judgment. It's the event of life. That's the event. You know, we talk about events in our lives, a wedding, a birthday, an occasion, Ramadan, Muharram, Hajj. We talk about events, life events, religious events, conferences. But the main event of every human being's life is al-waqi'ah, is the event of the Day of Judgment. Because that will be the day that we will be all taken to task and we will be made accountable to the Almighty. So the reality of this is being discussed in the surah, hence the name al-waqi'ah. It's a Makki surah, so the elements of our fundamentals and our creed are being mentioned in the surah. The Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, many a times would recite Suratul Waqi'ah in his prayer. There's a lot of virtue connected with it. There's a sound narration that speaks about Abdullah ibn Mas'ud telling his family and his household that recite Al-Waqi'ah and you will be protected from poverty. Similarly, we also find themes of the Day of Judgment. In this surah, Allah talks about the reality of the Day of Judgment, Al-Waqi'ah. It's an event that's going to happen. We cannot deny it. And Allah speaks about the various objections raised by the disbelievers and refutes them through these verses. Allah then speaks about the different categories of both humans as well as believers. In general, there are three in principle here. Allah speaks about regular believers or people on a general level of believers. And then Allah speaks about elite believers who are really dedicated and committed. And then Allah speaks about disbelievers. So three primary categories that Allah mentions here in the surah. And then Allah highlights four major blessings. Tumnoon. Do you not see your origins from the semen that I have created? So again, our system of procreation, it's a great blessing. We wouldn't have children. We wouldn't have offspring. We wouldn't have partners if Allah didn't create this system. So, tumnoon. Then, tahruthun. Allah speaks about vegetation and farming. Imagine there was no cultivation. Imagine there was no fruits and vegetables. Imagine there was no growth of plantations and roses and flowers and orchards, etc. All of this is beauty that satisfies us. So Allah highlights this as a blessing as well. تَشْرَبُونَ Allah speaks about water. We use water to drink. We use water to clean. We use water to cook. We use water for so many things. So Allah says, who brings that down? It's a blessing from me. And then Allah speaks about fire as a blessing. And here it can be indicative of heat, we need heat for climate. Sometimes it's too cold, so we have to we light fire. Or different methods that we can adopt to gain heat. So again, there's two messages here through the heat. One is that it's a profound blessing of Allah that we also use heat to cook, etc. So it's a great blessing of Allah. And number two is that it should remind us about a far more severe heat. قُلْ نَارُ جَهَنَّمَ أَشَدُّ حَرًّا And that is the hellfire. Four major blessings are being reminded about here in Al-Waqi'ah so that we can recognize the Creator, surrender to Him, follow His teachings, and be saved from the torment on the Waqi'ah, on the Day of Judgment. And then finally, Allah speaks about death and its reality as well. Our transition to the hereafter is through death. So I'll highlight a couple of verses here in the surah. Allah begins by talking about the earthquake of the Day of Judgment. رُجَّتِ الْأَرْضُ رَجَّ That when Allah decides to begin the Day of Judgment, the earth is going to tremble. And what everybody was awaiting is going to happen. Those who are alive, they will experience the Day of Judgment right before their eyes happening. Those who are dead, they will be resurrected. So as they are being resurrected, they will also experience the Day of Judgment. Allah speaks about the categories of people. ثُلَّةٌ مِّنَ الْأَوَّلِينَ وَثُلَّةٌ مِّنَ الْآخِرِينَ There is one third of the elite believers, and then there is one third of the others, and then there are the disbelievers. Allah then, after this categorization and what will happen with these various categories on the Day of Resurrection, Allah speaks about the bliss and the joy of paradise. And then on the reverse, Allah speaks about the pain and the torment in the hellfire. إِنَّهُ لَقُرْآنٌ كَرِيمٌ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the authenticity of the Qur'an, that it's come from a beautiful, authentic chain, from Allah to the angels, from the angels to the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. لَا يَمَسُهُ إِلَّا الْمُطَهَّرُونَ That it's only those who are pure at heart that will benefit and touch the true message of the Qur'an. And this is the verse that also scholars deduce that when we touch the Qur'an, we should ensure that we are in the state of purity, meaning we have wudu, because Allah says it is only the pure that touch the Qur'an. Nevertheless, towards the end of the surah, Allah comes back to one of the first themes, and that is the categories of the people. فَأَمَّا إِن كَانَ مِنَ الْمُقَرَّبِينَ As for those who are elite and very close to Allah, فَرَوْحٌ وَرَيْحَانٌ وَجَنَّةُ نَعِيمٌ They will be in endless joy in paradise. وَأَمَّا إِن كَانَ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ الْيَمِينِ Or they will be the people of the right, on a general level, believers. فَسَلَامٌ لَكَ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ الْيَمِينِ They will be greeted with greetings of peace and entered into paradise. And then وَأَمَّا إِن كَانَ مِنَ الْمُكَذِّبِينَ الضَّالِّينَ And then those who reject, those who deny, those who don't believe, Allah says, there's disgrace for them awaiting in the hellfire. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for protection. The last surah that is in this juz is surah Al-Hadid. Hadid refers to iron. And in this surah, Allah speaks about the strength of iron. And Allah also speaks about the benefits of iron or metal, and how we use it as human beings as an important resource. You know, we construct with it. We fortify ourselves with it. We create armor with it. We protect ourselves in warfare with it. So there's so many benefits of this iron that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed humanity with. And because this is mentioned in the surah, that's why the name of this chapter is Al-Hadid. It's a Madani surah, which is different than the rest of the surahs in this juz. So Madani meaning that it was revealed after the Prophet ﷺ migrated to Medina. So as we know, in any of the Madani surahs, we generally find not too many emphasis on aqidah or creed, rather more to do with laws, more to do with how to build a society on Islamic ethos, on building and establishing a community on morals and ethics. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this in the surah as well. It's noted that the Prophet ﷺ recited Surah Al-Hadid every single night before going to sleep. Surah Al-Hadid every single night before he would go to sleep, he would recite this surah. It speaks about the greatness of God, the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It also highlights a spending in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's path, infaq fi sabilillah. When the verse was revealed from the surah, man dhal ladhi yuqridu Allah qardan hasana, who is there that will give a goodly loan to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And Allah doesn't need a loan. It's just a way that, it's a technique that Allah utilizes to tell us that your rewards are secure with Allah. You know, in this world, when we loan someone money, when we give someone money, and in many occasions, we are unsure if it will be returned to us. And how many cases of people who have borrowed money and they can't return the money back to the rightful owners. So Allah says, when you give in my path, meaning you help the Prophet ﷺ, the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you donate, you are charitable, Allah says it's like a secure loan. And you will get the returns. And Allah will give us multiplied rewards when we when Allah gives us that return back. So again, the point here is that the spending in Allah's path. So there's an incident about this verse in Surah Hadid that Abu Dahda radiallahu anhu, he had an orchard, he had a land with a lot of vegetation. His family was enjoying the scenery and the shade of that land and the water of the land. And when he heard this verse, he came darting to his family in this orchard and he said, I've given this orchard as a loan to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the family, they were in rejoicing. They were saying, this is for the cause of Allah. We are happy to do this. And they walked out and they gave it in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the attitude of a believer. How a believer engages in surrendering and giving in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in this surah, Allah speaks about the light of guidance and the darkness of misguidance. Allah speaks about having soft hearts, that when truth comes to us, if we have soft hearts, we will embrace the truth, we won't deny it, we won't show arrogance unnecessarily. And then Allah speaks about the five phases of life. لعب له زينة تفاخر and تكاثر. What are the five phases of life? لعب, which means amusement and play. له also refers to amusement and being distracted. And then زينة means adornment, beauty. And then تفاخر, being arrogant. And then تكاثر, competing with one another. So the younger we are, the more we're playing, the more we're enjoying amusement. Then when we pass this stage, it's more to do with our zina and our adornment, that I'm wearing this brand and I own this and I own that. And then tafakhur, and then being full of arrogance and competing with others, that I have this and you don't have that, and I own this and I and you own that, and my children are doing this and your children are doing that. So Allah says this is the life that generally people pass by in these phases. But a believer knows what to do in every one of these phases and these stages. Allah says, hasten towards the good. Believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and recognize the truth. And then finally in the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about spiritual and physical strength and highlights some of these lessons through the story of a few prophets. So in Surah Hadid, I'll highlight a few verses and then inshallah conclude this session. So Allah begins by talking about himself. And what he does here in this Surah Hadid, he talks about his attributes. So Allah says he is Muhyi, he is the one that gives life. Al-Basir, he is all-observing. He is Al-Qadir. He is Al-Awwal, Al-Akhir, he is the first of the first, he is the last of the last. So all of these are attributes that denote that Allah is in authority, he is in power. لَهُ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. To him belongs the kingdom of the heavens and the earth. And then Allah says, وَمَا لَكُمْ لَا تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. What has stopped you from believing in Allah and the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, whereas the Prophet has come to you? He's advising you through profound verses that are being revealed by God. And then Allah speaks about the Day of Judgment. يَوْمَ تَرَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ. On the Day of Judgment, Allah gives us a scenery. The believers will be on one side, the disbelievers will be on another. نُورُهُمْ يَسْعَى بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ. The believers will be guided with a divine light. And that is that light of guidance which they adhere to in this world. And the disbelievers, those who reject it, those who transgress, they will be in darknesses because of their misguidance in this world, of not making the choice to embrace the truth. And then Allah says, أَلَمْ يَأْنِنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْ تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Has the time not come that believers now are full of inspiration and fear in hearing these verses and the message of the Quran that would inspire them to take the right step? So when the Sahaba heard these verses, they said, yes, this is the time has come. We are surrendering and we are embracing the truth. And then Allah again tells us, vie with one another. سَابِقُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. In this world, we compete with one another on different things. Like I said earlier, لَهُ لَعِبْ زِينَ, etc. Amusement, play, ego, and competing in material. Allah says, take advantage of your life to compete with one another in acts of righteousness. Not out of arrogance, but to excel in doing good. And that will lead you to the bliss and of goodness in the hereafter. And then the conclusion of this surah in this Juz 27, Allah speaks about three prophets: the Prophet Nuh, the Prophet Ibrahim, and the Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah said, I sent all of them, and I gave them revelation. فَمِنْهُمْ there were those who believed, there were those who embraced, and there were those who went beyond limits. وَمِنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. There were those who transgressed the limits. So Allah says that learn from their communities and learn from these prophets. And then towards the end of this juz, Allah says, وَاللَّهُ ذُو الْفَضْلِ الْعَظِيمِ. That Allah's bounty is with those who turn to Him. So the bounty of revelation, the bounty of peace and prosperity, the bounty of paradise, these are grace to the one who turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this concludes the juz. We make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the reality of these verses that were discussed today and this chapter, juz 27. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us true people of the Qur'an, and Allah inspire us and protect us through the blessings of the Qur'an. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the best of success. Until tomorrow's session, jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.